الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما نافعا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم. صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم.
My dear respected brothers and elders, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me and you the tawfiq, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inspire me words that becomes the deliverance and the means for our salvation and the reason for our salvation in the latter world, in the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Because my mouth is too small to talk about the Quran and Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but all the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is haq, it is truth, it is haq. There is no doubts. That's why Allah, the first ayat Allah reveals in Surah Al-Baqarah, La Rayba Fi, before you go into this legislation, before you go into this Quran, before you start understanding the translation and the interpretation of the Quran, the first thing is remove all doubts from your heart. Keeping this in mind, then Allah will give you hidayat, will give you guidance through this Quran. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before me coming into this ayat of the Quran, Allah has been so generous and so merciful upon me and you. This generosity, this mercifulness, we will not understand and we will not realize until we die, until death catches upon us. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Every soul will taste death. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent 124,000 famous Nabis to Ibn Adam to remind them of Akhirah, to remind them of Qiyamah. Because we have forgot the lesson that Allah questioned me and you. We have forgotten the question that Allah asked the whole creation when all of us was our ruh and our body, without the body, our ruh, when it was in the alami arwah, in the world of the ruh, the spiritual world, when Allah asked, Alastu bi Rabbi, aren't I not your Rabb? We all confessed, we said, Qalu bala, surely Rabb, you are surely our Rabb. After Ibn Adam, the children of Adam coming to this world, we have all forgotten. We have forgotten. So Allah sent all these Anbiya والسلام, to remind only one lesson that Allah said in the alami arwah, Alastu bi Rabbikum. And to bring this into action, Allah has sent us in this world. To bring this into action, Allah has sent me and you in this world. Now the system of Anbiya is finished. The system of Anbiya is finished. The last Nabi was Muhammad Rasulullah. Now we, as being the Ummah of Muhammad Rasulullah, we have many duties upon this deen. We have many duties. But I want to especially today talk about this surah, because this is a very small and concise surah, but a very, very comprehensive surah. And it is one of the awwaleen, one of the first surahs to be revealed in Makkah. The surahs that was revealed in Makkah was short, but very comprehensive and deep meaning. The surahs that was revealed in Makkah was short but very comprehensive. Now this surah Allah has revealed, if you try to understand the meaning and the deeper meaning, if you try to understand what Allah is trying to say, like the way Imam Shafi said, لَوْ لَمْ يَنْزِلِ اللَّهِ سِوَيْ هَذِهِ السُّورَةِ لَكَفَّتِ النَّاسِ. That Imam Shafi said, if Allah did not reveal the whole Quran, if Allah did not reveal the whole of the Quran and He just revealed this surah, then this surah will be sufficient for all mankind until the day of Qiyamah. Now what is this surah? What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying? What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying? We need to understand. Allah, in this surah, it is called Surah Al-Asr. Allah says, first I will go through the translation. Allah says, Wal-Asr. He takes oath and qasam in the name of Asr, time. Innal insana lafi khusr. Allah says that human creation are in loss, in destruction. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Exception, except for those people who are doing good deeds, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, who believe in Allah and doing good deeds, وَتَوَاسُوا بِالْحَقِّ, and they recommend and encourage of truth, of haqq. وَتَوَاسُوا بِالصَّالِحَاتِ, and they encourage and recommend of patience. This is just the literal meaning of the surah. Allah takes oath of Wal-Asr. You see, Allah taking the oath. Allah takes oath in many places in the Quran. What importance was it for Allah to take oath? We cannot take oath of any creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can only take oath of Allah if the condition and the matter is so serious only. There's conditions of taking oath as well. In the fuqaha, they have laid out These conditions you can take oath. So Allah in the Quran takes oath on many things of His creation. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. Allah takes oath of the sun. وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا. He takes oath of the moon. وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا. He takes oath of the day. وَالسَّمَاءِ وَمَا بَنَاهَا. He takes oath of the sky. وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا طَحَاهَا. He takes oath of the earth. Why is Allah taking oath? Why is Allah taking qasam? To show the importance of something. Now why did Allah specifically take the oath of the time? The scholars, they have written and they have interpreted many reasons. You see, human creation, he can reject and deny the existence of God, like the atheist. He can reject and deny the existence of God, the existence of the Creator. He can deny everything, keep on denying and denying and denying. But he cannot deny time. Time brings end to everything. Time will tell you. According to another narration, Allah is taking the oath of Salatul Asr. According to another narration, Allah is taking the oath of the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But majority of the Mufassirun have written that Allah is taking the oath of time. Time is such a thing, brothers, it's so precious. Time is so precious. Wallahi, wallahi, I'm saying in the house of Allah, the Sahabas, they never took as serious of their wealth, their possessions and their money as serious as what they have took in their time. They were not ready to give time to anyone. This is how important the Sahabas took their time. Every moment they took it as valuable. Every second they have took it as valuable. That's why the Sha'ir, he says, حَيَارَتُكَ أَنْفَاسُ تُعَدُّ فَكُلَّمَا إِذَا قَضَى نَفْسُهُ مِنْهَا إِذَا قَضَى نَفْسُهُ مِنْهَا إِنْ قَصَدْتَ بِهِ جُزْعًا. The Sha'ir, he says, that he gives an example of time. He gives the example of time. He says, your time is like breath. When one breath goes, you should remember, you should think that one great portion of your life has gone. You should think that when one breath goes, when you are taking away one breath, you should think, brothers, please brothers, don't talk. I can hear people talking. Please, listen carefully. حَيَاتُكَ أَنْفَاسُ تَعُدُّ فَكُلَّمَا. When one breath is gone from your life, remember this, a big portion you have lost in your life. A big portion. And Allah Ta'ala, specifically, He's talking about wal-asr. You see, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said in a hadith that from today, everyone who's sitting here, yes? If we think very seriously and we think to ourselves, from today onwards, within the next 100 years, every single person here may be not here. And after 100 years, people not gonna remember about us. We will become what? We'll become a history. And whatever we had, our possessions and everything in this world, is all inherited by other people. Even so much so, the children can't even claim sometimes, even the government becomes the inheritor. So we are working hard and striving and we are doing it for someone else, we're not doing it for ourselves. So Allah Ta'ala takes qasam of time. You see, there was a moment, هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. Allah says that there was a moment and time where me and you was not mentioned. Who knew Habibur Rahman 31 years old before, 31 years before, who knew that he's going to be sitting here and talking to you? Did I know? Did you know? No one knew. We didn't have this knowledge. Who knew 31 years ago that we will be sitting in this place, on this platform, and talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We didn't have this information. No technology, no scientist had ever had this information. You know, the technologies and the scientists and the modern world, so-called, they do many experiments. Even so, they're experimenting out of this world, looking in space, in different planets, trying to find some source of water so that they can go and live there as well. Maybe something happens in this world, we can go and live down there. Trying to get away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to get away from Allah. There's no getaway, brothers. مِنْ أَخْطَارِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فَانْفُذُوا لَا تَنْفُذُونَ إِلَّا بِالسُّلْطَانِ. This is what Allah says in the Quran. There's no getaway. So, what I'm trying to explain is that time is something that no one can deny. No one can deny. And time will tell you what you have done in your life. Time will tell you when the time is up, when your round is finished, and then you will start thinking, what did I do in 60 years of my life? What a great loss. What a great loss. All my life I've been doing it for my kids. All my life I've been doing it for my family. All my life I've been doing it for my wife. All my life, end of the day, what do? Nashukri. They don't be thankful. They don't be grateful. And then at the end of your life, the only thing you have is anxiety, worry, concern. Kya kya? What did I do? What did I do? What did I do? This is all you have at the end of your life. So Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Insan, human creation, is in loss, in destruction. Now, loss can be, to explain this, loss can be, for example, in a transaction. In a transaction, when a person is gaining, his business is rising, he's getting benefit, he's a winner. But sometimes people in business, they get lost as well. They get a goal. They get lost. So what does this loss mean in time? Which means that in a person's life, every second that you are actually losing in your life, are you gaining or losing? You are losing. Because when you are losing your time, you are actually in lost. You are actually in lost. You are in great lost. That's why Allah says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ. Except for those people who have iman. We don't understand what is iman. We don't give the value of this iman today, brothers. Iman today is just in the books. Brothers, iman is just in the book nowadays. It's all in the books. It's not in here. You see this little heart we have here, the size of a hand is not in there. It's all in the books. But iman is something, brothers. In many various hadiths, Rasulullah explained. What is iman? The sahaba's question, Ya Rasulullah, what is iman? Rasulullah said, إِذَا سَرَّتْكَ حَسَنَاتُ وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَاتُ فَذَٰلِكَ الْمُؤْمِنِ. When a person is doing something for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it can be in any form, it can be anything. When a person is doing something for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what happens? His ruh, his soul, his iman is increasing and elevating and elevating and increasing. You know what? You know the sahabas? The sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. In every history, the believing people and the non-believers, they have to remember them.
And they have to say radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. Because these people, their iman was to a level that was not no parable. Their iman was to a level that was no parable. That's why today we have many Muslims in the world. In the time of Rasulullah, there was few. There was a few sahabas in Mecca. But these people were people of substance. These people were people of substance. They had quality, brothers. We don't have quality today. We don't have the quality of our iman. We have iman, but we're not having the quality of our iman. So what is iman? The hadith says, إِذَا سَرَّتْكَ حَسَنَاهُ. When you do something for Allah, your ruh goes up and you become so happy, so joyful, that believe me, £1 million doesn't feel you so happiness in your heart. This is here in the heart. This is in your heart. This £1 million will not make you happy, brothers. وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَاتُ. Now, if a person has iman, it's like a vibration. If a person has iman, it's like a vibration. This person who's got iman in his heart, if he's in the discos, if he's in the light club, believe me, he will have some sort of anxiety and worry in his heart. If this person has iman, if he's drinking, then definitely he will have some sort of worry and anxiety in his heart. If this person has iman in his heart and he knows he's doing haram and he's always concerned and worried, then this person will definitely, he will be worried. So what means, إِذَا سَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَاتُ. When doing something wrong, when committing haram, your heart tells you that this is wrong. And your body becomes restless. Your mind becomes restless. You know you have done a grievous sin, even though it's small. Even though it's small. What I'm trying to say is, the hadith says of Rasulullah that when a believer commits something wrong, even though it's a quantity of small, it's like the whole mountain on his head. And a hypocrite, when he does a big sin, when I'm talking about a big sin, what happens? It's like a fly on his nose and he just moves the fly away. He just moves the fly away. Because what is happening? His iman has become corroded. So this is, Allah talks about iman. وَعَمِلُ الصَّالِحَةِ. It's not sufficient for you just to say, okay, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That's it. That's my duty, finished. I've done my duty with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I've signed the contract now. That's it, finished. No more. No, brothers. Allah says, وَعَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. Without means, you are not going to Jannah. Without a certificate, you are not going to go to Jannah. The certificate is Al-Amal. Al-Amal. It's like going to exam hall. It's like going for a job. And you're going for a job and you're saying, I want this job, I love this job. I want this job. It's a very big position job. I'm going to get 5,000 a year. But sorry, I don't have a CV. I can't do nothing. I don't have a CV. I don't have any qualifications. How are you going to get the job? Now Jannah, paradise, when Allah says, what is paradise? There's no example of paradise in this world. And you think you're going to get paradise for free, brothers. You think paradise is cheap. You think paradise is something that, okay, I just do a couple of sajidas and give my zakat and just do hajj. No. There's so much for Islam. And what are we doing to contribute towards Islam? It is each and every individual duty to contribute to Islam in any manner. That's every, not an imam, not an a'imma. Every person, it is his duty to give a contribution towards Islam. And then Allah says, وَتَوَاسُوا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسُوا بِالصَّبْرِ. And He encourages good and forbids from evil. He encourages good, which means this ayah is giving an inclination of Amr bin Ma'ruf وَالنَّهِ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. He encourages good and He encourages patience. Encouraging good means encouraging for good deeds, and encouraging from patience means that refraining from all those things that will displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is in total meaning. That's why the scholars have written, if a person says, Alhamdulillah, I read namaz, I give zakat, that's it, my duty is finished. It's not enough. Your duty is not finished. Your duty sometime to give da'wat, to call to Islam, it becomes farz. For example, your children, your family members, your ahl, your people who's under your supervision, to give them da'wat, to call them towards Jannah, sometime it becomes farzi ayn, like the way salat becomes farz. So it's not sufficient for a person to say that I'm reading salat, that's it. I don't have any more other duties. There's many duties in Islam, but one of the icing of the cake, the top of the cake, is da'wat. Da'wat is the only source and mean, and the only instrument that Islam has come to me and you. Islam has come to me and you. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not guide us, then if Allah did not guide our previous, then maybe guidance would not be come to us. So this is all happening from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is a duty from every single one of us to contribute towards Islam. Jazakallah khairan. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.